the whole issue of who gets worshipped and who gets prayed to in the Bible is significant for the wider discussion, and that is, who is God in the Bible and who is not God in the Bible? You cannot get more basic than that. We start with the fact, of course, that Jesus was a unitary monotheist, an absolute monotheist, not a Trinitarian monotheist. This is demonstrably true in Mark chapter 12 and verse 29, where Jesus agrees with the Jew. We know the Jews do not believe in the triune God, and Jesus is quite upfront with him, agreeing totally with him. But God is not a triune God. Jesus had never heard of that. Well, if he'd heard of it, he would have rejected it immediately. So the issue first is to establish who is God. There's only one God. That God is the Father. That's stated clearly in Jesus' recitation of the Jewish creed from Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 and 5. The unitary monotheism of Jesus is absolutely clear. That said, we will understand immediately that if Jesus is worshipped as he is in the Bible, if he's prayed to as he is in the Bible, then it must not prove that he's God. We've already established that he isn't God from his creed. That's the fixed point, the fixed datum out of which we must work. Then it becomes very interesting when we examine the word worship, examine the word prayer, and you must look at the original languages here, because many of you are relying on a translation, and a translation is the most subtle form of interpretation, sometimes misleading interpretation, because translators will translate with a bias in favor of their theological system. You must look at the original words, and you'll find that the word to worship, proskineo, is the big word in both the Greek Old Testament and in the New Testament, and it's offered both to God and superior men, elevated human beings. So that puts an end to the argument that if proskineo is offered in your direction, it means you're God. It simply doesn't. If proskineo meant you were God, then this would mean that the king of Israel was God, and so on. It would mean the saints are God in Revelation chapter 3. So, as far as prayer is concerned, the same principle applies exactly. In Isaiah 45:14, you'll find that Israel, the nation, is prayed to and worshipped. Think about that. So, if you pray to somebody, it doesn't mean necessarily that they are God. This leaves room for us to consider the fact that God is the ultimate one worshipped, the ultimate one prayed to as God. However, Jesus is prayed to in John 14:14. The Christians in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 2 are those who appeal to the name of Jesus. You'll find a very interesting text in 1 Timothy 1:12 where Paul gives thanks to Jesus for putting him in ministry. We all know that giving thanks is a form of prayer. So these rigid divisions and limitations that are placed on words by some people simply don't work out. You have to do the word study carefully. Remember then that Paul thanked Jesus for putting him in ministry. That's a form of prayer, so relax. Stephen also prayed to the Lord Jesus. That's not very difficult. Allow the scriptures to breathe. Stop imposing upon them your fixed dogmas, and the great dogma, which you shouldn't impose on scripture, is the triune God dogma. That's the thing that's throwing everything into confusion.